Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Developing My Loving Self group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the session 1 group feedback presentation, Jesus gives some powerful group feedback regarding the desire for denial that remains within many listening to divine truth, and how it affects them personally and the dangers involved in the emotional refusal to accept and have compassion for our facade. Recorded on the 5th of June 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
Graham, you want to ask something?
Could I just ask a question and ask a question like you asked, did we have any?
I would like to talk about the group feedback because it's important feedback that I'd like to give you all as a group.
Okay.
And I think the group feedback will help a lot of people, whereas the question you might ask might not do so. So I want to focus on two primary points with this group feedback. The first point I would like to discuss with you is the desire for denial. So that's the subject of the first point. Now here I'm talking primarily about the denial of your sin, but the reality is that this is where you do most of your denial, up in your facade. And many of you don't realise what it does to you, like how damaging it is to you to deny things and how difficult it is for somebody who can see something when you are in denial of what they can see, because they can't help you, even though they could help you, you know, because they know, but they can't help you because there's nothing they can do to share it with you. Now this particularly applies to your guides and your guardians at different times, but mostly your guides, because your guides, remember, are guiding you to more and more truth, right? So your guide is a person who wants you to grow in truth. They want you to become more aware of what the truth is. Now, what's the facade all about? Lies. It's all about suppressing the truth, controlling the truth, manipulating the truth, lying outright, or being in a state where you're minimizing the truth and justifying your lie-based position. Now, when you're in this place here, it's very, very hard for your guide to assist you. Very difficult. And so for many of you, you've got lovely guides, but they're struggling to have a connection with you because you're wanting to stay in a state of denial. Last week we had an interesting conversation at the end of our week that we were sitting down outside at the, in the eatery, what's it called, cafe. And somebody asked me, what do you think my main issue is? Well, besides raising the fact that it's now placing responsibility on me to tell, I decided, I'll answer that question. And I said to her, the main issue is that you don't believe that anything I've ever said to you applies to you. See, if you don't believe it applies to you, then you're not going to do anything about it. So many of you sit in these audiences and you go, that doesn't apply to me, 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 oh, that applies to me, I might have a look at that. When the reality is, that does apply to me, 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 and the very thing you thought applied to you applies to you less. You know why? Because you can see it. And all those things you can't see are all the things you're in denial of. And nobody, God included, can do anything to help you. God's not going to force you to get out of a state of denial and into a state of awareness. That is a personal will-based choice, to get out of a state of denial into a state of awareness. Now, God's already got, all of God's laws are trying to get you out of a state of denial and into a state of awareness. All of God's angels, or the celestial spirits in particular, are all trying to help you get out of denial into awareness. But if a very if a person standing in front of you mentions something and it just goes, no, it doesn't apply to me, then do you think those people who you can't see have any greater way of assisting you than I do? Of course they don't. They might be trying to say exactly the same thing to you, but you're going, doesn't apply to me, doesn't apply to me, doesn't apply to me. You see? And every single thing you think doesn't apply to you probably applies to you. And the things you think do apply to you, well, at least you're now aware that it applies to you. And that means that you're in less danger on those issues than the other issues that you believe don't apply to you. Does that make sense to you? Yep. The denial techniques need to be examined. And one very powerful denial technique is to just say to yourself that that doesn't apply. You can skip over a mountain of things like that. It also means that there's no allowance of an emotional response to this, what's being said. Because you've already dismissed it. It's like through one ear, in one ear, out the other. You've dismissed it emotionally. And because you've dismissed it emotionally, it's impossible for there to be any further acknowledgement, awareness, development at all within you on that particular issue until you allow some kind of emotional response to what's being said. Now, I know in these presentations we do say things quite rapidly, but we record them for that purpose so that you can go home, rewatch and listen to them more slowly and see what's being said to you. And in that place where you see what's being said to you and you feel what's being said to you, if you feel it, you now have a chance to become more aware and to determine the truth. But if you don't even feel it and you just say that doesn't apply, then what is going to happen is that you will not be any more aware than you were the moment before. And on top of that, the people who you cannot see cannot do anything to help you with that particular thing. Now, I've received in my progression a lot of guidance. The only way I've received that guidance is by being open to everything being said to me and assess everything that's being said to me. Does that make sense? And instead of going, that doesn't apply to me, I always go, maybe it does apply to me, it's getting said to me. So maybe it does apply to me. I need to write that down and then feel about this issue enough to determine whether it does apply or not. But denial is a powerful tool. So I was talking to the lady who asked me the question last week. And I said to her that the majority of the time, what I notice her doing is thinking that pretty much everything being said, she loves what's being said. And the main reason why she loves it is because she believes it only applies to someone else. And the reality is when you start applying a lot of what's said to you, initially, once your facade is confronted, you'll start not loving what's being said. So you'll go through that phase where you don't love what's being said. And many do not come out the other end, and I'll talk to you about that in a minute. In other words, they never go beyond getting upset about what's being said. But we'll talk about that as a separate issue. This issue of denial means that I don't even have to get upset about it. I don't even have to have an emotional response about it. I can just completely ignore it. I can act like it's never happened. I can sit in the room and not participate and not even let anything affect me emotionally. And isn't it wonderful? I just get soaked with all this truth that applies to other people. All the while, never making any personal progress. And that's what I said to her. The whole time I've known her, 7 years now, I've not seen a single piece of personal progress. And the reason why I haven't seen it, not even a beginning of an awareness. And she loves coming to most events, not a beginning awareness, because she never applies anything to herself. Powerful state of denial of your facade. Does that make sense? Would you like to ask any questions about that? It's pretty clear what the problem is there. Yeah. Alex, you'd like to ask?
I'm not sure if it's about the deconstruction of a facade or particularly about this.
Yep.
Just clarifying if I understood the previous session.
Can I stay on this subject?
Yeah, sure.
So I need you to be sure.
Okay. All right. Specifically about denial.
Yeah.
Do you need to come to recognize your denial and then recognize why you do it?
Like what I feel needs to happen first, Alex, is to develop an aspiration to actually see your denial. Like that's the very first thing, to actually be aware that you are denying. Now, for most people, and even to develop an aspiration to see that you are denying, I feel that most people have a strongly developed aspiration to deny, right? And to therefore not see what they're in denial of. Now, and this is something that does apply to you, because I see this happening for you a lot, where you don't see the unloving behavior you exhibit towards other people in an effort to have power and control over them. And this is also why you attract some quite dark spirits with you who want to take power and control over other people, because you can't see what you have going on with these spirits. You don't see what's going on, why you desperately need this power and control. It's a lot to do with your father, a lot to do with emotions related to him, not with women. Right, and you have a definite favoritism towards trying to develop and feel emotions about women, when actually a lot of your really worst sins are about trying to take power and control over others through stages of manipulation and bribery. Right, and so how do you get from the state where you don't believe that at all? And I've said that to you a number of times, and you don't believe it at all. You don't believe it even matters. Like that, you believe I'm wrong. You're allowed to believe I'm wrong. So I'm okay with you believing you're wrong. I'm wrong. But what I'm suggesting to you is that unless you get out of the state of denial, there's very little progress you make in that area, because you won't even allow yourself to see the possibility of it being true, let alone whether it is true or not, or analysing whether it is. You've got to, before you can progress, you've got to see the possibility of something being true or not. So whenever anybody says anything to me, the very first thing I consider is everything is possible. So it's possible what they're saying to me is true. Then what I have to do is allow myself to feel about it, analyze my behavior and my conduct, analyze what I do with other people, analyze my motivations, analyze what's motivating me, and then I'll be able to see whether what's being said is true or not. But that requires me first getting out of the state where I'm already dismissing the possibility. You follow? You follow? I've got to stop dismissing the possibility of it being true before I can actually analyze whether it is true. And what I see the majority of you doing is dismissing the possibility of it being true before you even analyze whether it is true or not. Now, if you're doing that with me, you're definitely doing that with God. If you're doing it with someone you can see, you're definitely going to be doing that with someone you can't see. And your spirit guides and God, you can't see. So you're going to be definitely doing it with them if you're already doing it with me. And this is what I'm suggesting to you. You need to get out of this state of dismissing the possibility before you've even got to the point of analysing it. Do you follow? And this is what I see most people doing. They're dismissing the possibility of things before they even analyse what's really going on. And by dismissing the possibility, it's highly likely that you will not analyse the possibility of it being true. And I feel that's the problem, Alex. That's where the problem is.
Can I just ask you? I don't see it because I don't really have laws of attraction with men. I work with women. I'm surrounded by women. And just lately, I feel a lot of condescension coming from them.
Yeah, I can't agree with any of the statements you've just made.
Okay.
Yeah. Most women, you're condescending with most women. I wouldn't say the opposite to that. The way you treat women is, actually, most women are scared of you. One reason why they get angry with you is because they're scared of you. And you know that whenever a person's afraid, you know, poke their fear and they bash you back, right? And this is what you're doing with women. You poke their fear because the spirits with you in particular, want domination and control over women. And so you just being with these women pokes their fear, because the spirits with you are in this place where they want domination control. And you've wanted that in the past too. You've done that plenty of times with Mary and other people that I know, where you want domination and control. You use all sorts of manipulative techniques to get domination and control. And then when they angrily respond back to you, you say, they're being condescending or angry with me, and that's where my problem is. And this is like all self-denial to avoid what's really going on, to avoid your own unloving behavior in the beginning. Now, why do you engage this unloving behavior? The reason why is allocated to, or specifically about, how your dad is. You think about your dad. I know it's hard to be honest about your dad.
A prick.
Yeah, but let's be more like, what does he do? What is he? What does he do? How does he treat women?
He was a tyrant.
Yeah, he's a tyrant, a bully. What else? Well, isn't he a neo-Nazi?
He was very much a Nazi sympathiser.
Yeah, Nazi sympathiser. So he has that feeling of power, domination, control over people, which he would have engaged with you, surely.
Yeah.
That's why you feel he's a prick, right?
Yeah.
And I don't really like to use that word. He's a dominating, controlling, abusive man, is he not?
Well, I still feel, I just realised he's still with me and he's the one that's hurting me the most, actually.
He's your main attraction that you've completely blanked out to. He's your main attraction. He's still with you, still dominating your life, dominating what you do with other people. Do you follow?
Yeah, I just realised that.
And your fear of him that you don't want to address, that you want to skip over, your fear of him causes a lot of this other behaviour. You follow? It causes these other addiction-based behaviours that end up with you sinning, taking control, wanting control of others. It also attracts other nasty spirits to you too, because they're just as nasty as he is and you're just as afraid of them as you are of your dad. And as a result, you'll do what they want you to do. You're in what I call a codependency in order to get approval, right?
Yeah, they hurt me all the time.
Yeah, they do. That's your main attraction. But you're telling me your main attraction is women. I'm saying no, your main attraction is the very spirits that surround you who are men in this terrible state, right? That's your main attraction. And that's dominated by your fear of them and your willingness to do whatever they want to make the fear go away. You follow? So that's an illustration in your personal life of how you skip over the many times I've told you this. You've just let it go, let it go, let it go, let it go. Many times you've been told that. Now, if I'm telling you that, then don't you think your guide's trying to tell you that? And don't you think God's trying to tell you that probably? And when you reflect upon it, you can feel them there, right? You can feel your dad there and you can feel the influences. And you can feel how angry you are with them. And you can feel that it makes you feel small and powerless, and that's the motivation for why you want power, because you actually feel small and powerless. Does that make sense? You can feel those things. And when I say that to you, that's the thing you've dismissed the most. Does it make sense? So, Alex, if you need to cry, you can go out and we can go on to another question. Love you, man. Anyone else? Thanks, Yvonne. Just down the front here, thanks.
I was definitely one of those people for 7 years who said, that doesn't apply to me, that doesn't apply to me.
Yep. You're still doing that, actually.
Am I?
Yep.
Even though I'm thinking, well, which is why I'm here again.
Yeah, now I can call up a case for yourself, Joy, where over and over and over again Mary's talked to you about your treatment of Mary. And you keep dismissing it and you keep engaging the same treatment every time, condescension every time. So there's an issue. So it's straight over the top of your head. Does it make sense?
Thank you.
Yeah, but go on, what were you going to ask?
It wasn't until this morning that I kind of got, I need to emotionally process these things that I'm denying. And I was in complete denial that I was doing any of those.
So why things. Are you in denial? It's because you don't have compassion for your facade. You're not allowing yourself to see what you're doing in your facade, so you don't have compassion for it, you see? And as a result of that, you want to deny it. So anybody points something out, you want to deny that. It feels like there's so much judgment in you about doing something wrong that you can't be told that you're doing something wrong. Does that make sense? And that's because of a lack of compassion for how it got wrong. And this is why we raise the issue of accepting the facade. You see, the majority of you in this audience have not yet accepted your facade. In fact, I feel all of you haven't. Yeah. Mary has. Corny hasn't. Nobody else here I really know has. Oh, Eloisa is in the process of. If my son Tristan was here, I'd say he has. Right? But I don't know anybody else in this room that has accepted their facade yet. So the question becomes, how do I get to the stage of accepting my facade? And obviously we want to talk about that as well, don't we? So
can I ask one question before you move
sure.
on? When I look at all of those different tactics,
yep.
judgment was one that I do identify with.
Yes.
My question is, do we all generally do all of those things?
Yes.
Okay.
The biggest ones that you do are not the most obvious. Minimization and justification are two of the biggest techniques you all use. The ones you feel are the judgment of self, judgment of others, blame of self, blame of others, attack of self, attack of others. You feel those ones generally. Some of you are more sensitive to that. But these ones, it's like, don't even notice yourself doing it, and yet they are your most powerful techniques. That makes sense?
Thank you.
Yeah. So the key, again, is to allow ourselves to see. You know, it's a really good thing to see, very good thing to see. And I don't raise these personal issues with the Joy to, you know, harm you in any way. I'm just saying there's an example of it happening. See it. Let yourself see it.
Yeah, I've still got this false belief that truth hurts.
Yes. Not only that truth hurts, but see this whole thing that, oh, the truth hurts and so I better not see it is really in a way an excuse, because it's basically saying that it's better for me to hurt another person than it is to see something that might hurt me. That's really what you're saying. Whereas I sort of say it, well, even if the truth damn well hurts, you're better off having you hurt for something you've actually done than hurt someone else for something they haven't done. Isn't that not true?
Totally.
Yeah. So, yeah. So even this whole thing, oh, the truth hurts, so I'm going to reject it, is in a way an error-based thinking based on false beliefs that cause us to believe that, oh, I should prevent the truth. It's sort of like a justification of my prevention of truth because I'm not seeing the hurt I do to others by denying the truth. So what's, like, if you really loved other people, if you had a choice between you hurting and them hurting, what would you choose? And if you had a choice between you hurting because you did something wrong and them hurting for no reason at all, what would you choose? Surely you hurting would be a more loving thing, would it not, than actually them hurting for nothing they've done at all. That you've done it to them for no reason.
Obviously, I can see that that's more loving logically, but what I'm really doing is the other.
Yeah, what you're doing is you're using a pain-based false belief to justify your dismissal of truth at the same time as your attack of another. Does that make sense? And you're basically saying the pain you cause the other person's not as bad as the pain that you'll have to feel if you have to accept the truth. That's really what you're saying. And I can't agree. I can't agree with that. A person who has not done anything to harm you does not deserve anything from you that's negative. And if you have done something to harm them and they point out the truth to you, why does it hurt you? It's the truth. Why does it hurt you? Because you've got a false belief about truth. That's the only reason why it hurts you. Yeah.
Thank you.
Make sense?
Yep.
So we've got to see where we let ourselves off the hook here. You know, we're sneaky. Right? Always trying to let yourself off the hook for things that you're doing so that you don't see the harm that not only that you've done to others, but in the end that you finish up doing to your own soul. You finish up degrading your own soul in that place. You see, the unloving self is quite a conniving, sneaky, very clever, but it's not real clever, is it? It's not really clever. The clever thing would be to get to the pain, wouldn't it, and feel the terror. That would be the most clever thing. But the conniving, sneaky facade thinks, I'm clever. And really, it's just doing what the pain demands. See, many of you have seen your facade as the problem. And your facade's not the real problem. The problem is the pain that you don't want to feel, that has its demands and its autocratic nature. It's a tyrant. Many of you believe that your pain is true. To you, it's real. To you, it's true. It determines your current belief systems that you all believe that you believe are true. Right? So your pain becomes the very thing that's driving the facade. It's the engine behind. The denial of the pain is the engine behind the facade. It's like the facade's only there because it's doing what others and you demand it to do. It's the only reason why it's there. If you stop demanding that it does it, the facade would disappear. Can you see that? The fact that you're demanding that it does it means that the facade will remain. Right? It's going to remain until you deal with what the demands are on it. Right? And being in denial is not going to help you do that, you see. So I suppose what I'm getting at here in this little section that I wanted to raise was that denial is a powerful technique of avoidance. And for many of you, it just goes straight past you. Anyway, I can come up with a whole heap of funny things about that, but I'll leave it alone because many of you don't feel in the mood. But everything just goes past you so that you can say, that doesn't apply to me. Whereas if you allow everything to hit you, you now have the ability to say, maybe this does apply to me. I'm going to spend a little time with that to find out. Does that make sense? And that's a powerful place, actually. Much more powerful than just letting it go. Because now, anything that's said to you from your guides, from people you can't see, people you can see, you sit down and assess. You don't go into self-attack and you don't go into self-blame and you don't go into self-punishment. You're not trying to hurt other people with the process or hurt yourself with the process. You just assess. You assess it. And if you notice that two or three are saying it or five or six people are saying it, you assess more. And the time you really assess is when a person who's more loving than you are and you feel is more loving than you are says it. And you know that their motivation for saying it is because they love you and you can feel that motivation, then you would really assess. You see, you'd measure the person's character and nature, and if their character and nature demonstrates their concern for you, that it's real and loving, and not demanding, they're not requiring that you change or anything, they're just trying to help, then you would assess it more, would you not? Not less. But what I notice of what you assess is that most angry, violent and insistent people and spirits that are around you, that's the people you assess. And the most calm, rational, logical, loving and gentle people around you, you just completely ignore. What does that remind you of? Isn't that your childhood? The most demanding people around you, you assess. The most calm people, you ignore. It's got to change. The most calm, gentle people around you, the people who are in a better state of love than you are, they're obviously ones to listen to. Yeah. If we could hand the mic to Felix, thanks. Now, Felix, yeah. I'm not going to let you ask another question.
Oh, okay.
I've decided that I'm not. If you have the mic up higher, hold up. I've observed you be unloving many times this group already.
Oh, really?
Yeah, really. Okay. It's not this, oh, really? Okay. Really. Really unloving. Both to myself and to Mary and to others. And you have are totally clueless.
I am?
You are, because you just said, oh, really?
Tell me more.
And yet it's so serious that I'm actually considering not answering any of your questions anymore. That's how serious it is.
Okay.
So I'm not going to tell you more. That's all I'm going to tell you. You need to take responsibility to find out how you've been.
Unloving.
Yeah.
Okay.
To people in this group, to Mary and myself, in the last 3 days.
Okay.
Well, since you came Friday night. Since Friday night.
I was about being late and...
No, yeah. You need to assess. Okay, yeah. I'm not saying any more. All right. Okay. Anyone else? Nikki, thanks.
When we're judging other people for something specific,
yep.
Or if we're using any of those denial techniques for like blaming them for something or punishing them, can that be a pointer to something inside of ourselves that we're denying?
Definitely. Okay. Always.
Okay.
Not just can it be.
Always.
It always is.
Okay.
Always.
So that's a good...
Without fail.
Yeah. Yep. So that makes it easy to find out what we're denying.
Exactly. Yeah, can you see that any time judgment of another is triggered inside of myself, instantly there must be something I'm denying, because judgment of another is an unloving act. Therefore, it's an attack on the other character, the other person. Therefore, it's something that I must be...
judging inside of...
Well, it could be that, or it could be something that happened in your childhood where your mother or your father did that constantly and you're just very angry about that. You know, it could be a number of different things, couldn't it? But we definitely need to go there and look at it every time without fail.
Okay.
Good question.
Thanks.
All right. Any other questions about... thanks, Savannah.
I was just wondering, with you saying that we use... that we just let things go over our head and
yep.
not accept that we've got those issues ourselves, are you also talking about, like... just say with Alex receiving some personal feedback then,
yep.
like, so I find with some people, like when you're giving them feedback, I sort of think, oh, I'm not sure if that really relates to me. Are you also talking about those sorts of things? Like,
yeah.
So like if you raise personal issues with people, like you're trying to also help the rest of the group here with that very same issue?
Yes.
Okay, yep.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
There's many times in the past where that's happened in groups where I've allowed discussion of a certain subject for the reason that I feel it applies to the majority of the individuals in the audience. Yep. And yet for most of you, what I notice you're doing is going, oh, he's talking to Alex about that. Yep. I can now ignore this.
Yep, I definitely do that.
Yeah, what you should have learned from my interaction with Alex just earlier is that he has spirits around him that he's totally freaked out about. He denies his fear all the time. He denies he's afraid a lot, right? He thinks he's afraid of women. He's not afraid of women at all. He is willing to attack women. He's definitely not afraid of them. He does not want to be aware that he's afraid of something else. And then his fear, he tries to pander to them. And as a result of pandering to them, he does what they want. Now, many of you are doing that with spirits in different areas. You're pandering to people you're afraid of, and then you eventually, because of that manipulative feeling they have towards you, that they can manipulate your fear and you want to prevent it, they can manipulate you into doing things you didn't even want to do. Now, many of you say you want to be loving, so I'm saying to you, this is one problem you've got. You're only wanting to be loving as long as you're not afraid. Does that make sense? And if you think of your own life, Ivana, isn't that the case? Like the times when you've become unloving are the times when you've been afraid and you've thought that's justification enough to be unloving.
Yeah, definitely.
Which is exactly what Alex is doing.
Yep.
So it does apply to you, doesn't it?
Yeah, I guess I was more so trying to work out if I had that exact issue. Like,
yes, you're not. So, see, this is the trouble with the individual interactions is you're not thinking of the principle. You're thinking of the individual discussion.
Yep.
And this is where I'm trying to teach you principles. I'm trying to teach you, like, tools.
Yep.
And in that interaction with Alex, I was teaching you a tool. But most of you, you skipped over it. You thought it only applied to him, what I was saying, when actually the tool that I'm suggesting he starts using is to, if he could see where he's afraid, he would see how he's being manipulated. And every single one of you is afraid, so you need to see where you're being afraid so you know how you're being manipulated.
Yeah, I have been thinking about that sort of similar issue lately, but didn't really get anywhere with it. But
So the issue with Alex does apply, but it's just not, you don't mind not have the same spirits that he has.
Yeah, but I've still got this issues like being afraid of my parents and then, for example, my mum.
To them when you have to.
And then doing the exact same thing with like older women I found in particular.
Yep.
I do the exact same thing with them as what I do with my mum.
Yep.
And then, I've been wondering if I've got the same thing going on with
spirits. You're giving them power over you.
Yeah.
You then go and do things they want you to do.
I also do the same thing with people, like just say younger women.
Well, see, this is the thing, Ivana. If you really felt about it, you'd feel, now hang on a sec, I don't do it with every younger woman.
No.
I do it with the younger woman who have exactly the same feelings as my mother has towards me. See, then you'd be more sensitive.
Oh, because...
And you'd see.
I know that they'll accept that same treatment. Is that what you mean?
Well, they want you to engage that same behaviour.
Yeah.
So you do. So this shows you how you've been manipulated when you're in those circumstances and situations. Exactly the same principle as I was talking about with Alex. But because you skip over the Alex thing, you think that doesn't apply to you. So now what I said to him doesn't apply to you and I've now had to say it to you.
Oh, yeah, sorry.
That's all right.
I didn't even think about that.
But can you see I've just repeated myself now with Alex and you.
Yep.
And that's because pretty much everyone in the audience when I was talking to Alex didn't feel what I was saying to him applied to them.
Yeah, yep. Okay, cool. Yeah. Thank you.
Yep. This is where I'm saying, I say these things, you think, if it goes, see that go past and then that goes past. That applied to somebody else. You know? And really, you don't realise as you watch each one go past what's happening. What does this look like to you? No, not me. No, isn't it? That's really what's going on. Just don't want anything to apply to you. Denial, that is called. Yeah. Graham, thank you. At the back. You have to stand, Graham.
I was just wondering if denial is something to do with arrogance as opposed to it just doesn't apply to me.
Well, it's a method of arrogance, isn't it? Sometimes it has to do with fear, sometimes arrogance. It's up to you to discover what the motivation is, right? And no one else is responsible and God will not take responsibility for you to decide what the motivation is. You need to work out the motivation for yourself. Right. See, this is, many of you still don't get the lessons from our first group, the lessons of will. You're the one who is going to have total control over your relationship with God. And your education in love is going to completely depend upon how you personally deal with all of these things with regard to how you use your will. It's got nothing to do with me. I'm just helping you with tools, things that I've discovered. I'm telling you God's love exists. I'm telling you you can be educated in love. I'm telling you how to get educated in love. I'm telling you why you're even denying the education in love. I'm telling you what you do with your techniques to stop the education in love. I'm telling you how you could develop techniques to grow an education in love and you're still not satisfied because you want to tell me your exact emotion. Does that make sense?
Mm. Thanks.
And then when I tell you exact emotion, what happens?
I deny it.
I deny it.
Yeah.
Because I didn't want to know it in the first place.
Right.
That's why.
Thanks.
We need to have a longing to know, a longing for the truth, a longing for the truth about yourself. Right? Because if we're going to develop your loving self, you're going to have to learn to know yourself. That's what it's all about, knowing the truth about yourself. The truth about yourself is wonderful, actually. And I'm not being facetious there. The truth about yourself is wonderful in the fact that your real self has so much power and so much potential, so much ability that you are going to be so impressed with yourself in the long run. You are. You're going to see yourself as the pinnacle of God's creation. Don't you think that's going to be impressive? Once you see that, right? But you can't do that unless you go through this process of understanding your unloving self. Because what your unloving self is blocking the development of that true, powerful being. So every time you let the truth fly past, you're blocking your own happiness. You're blocking your own development. You're blocking your own relationship with God. You're blocking your own education. And God is a gentle being. God is not going to force you to change from that place. God is powerful, but gentle. He is never going to overcome how you use your will. Ever. Isn't that wonderful? What a gift. He gives us free will, and then he says, I promise I am never going to do anything to harm it. No matter how bad you are or how good you are, I'm just not going to do anything to harm how you use your will. I've got laws that govern the universe that make sure everything in the universe continues to function no matter how you use your will. I've even got a whole heap of laws, God's saying to you, I've got a whole heap of laws that will actually redeem you from using your will badly. What amazing thing. That's how gentle God is. And yet we're going, burr, 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 burr. It's all going past us, you know. It's all going past us. We're thinking we're doing ourselves a favour by remaining in denial. It's one of the very worst things you can do to yourself. If you remain in denial about all these different issues, nothing can change, nothing can grow. You will never be the powerful being that God created you to be if you keep staying in denial. Does that make sense? Yep. So that's the first issue I wanted to raise, the issue of denial. You're okay with that? Yep, we finished with that, or one more question about it, Amber, and then we move on. Just make sure of my time. Yep, it's not too bad. Fire?
I was just wondering if it can go the opposite way where you actually don't deny enough and accept all the lies and just everything, like you're gullible.
No, what I'm saying is you allow the possibility to come into you. Then you assess.
Yeah, yeah.
Now, a person who makes these assessments assesses everything through four primary tools. What are they?
Action.
Yes.
Faith.
Yes.
Truth.
Truth.
And humility.
Humility. Yep.
Yeah.
Aside from obviously the major one of love, right? So,
yeah.
So you're assessing everything based on that. Now, if you find yourself getting attacked in that process, if you assess and you go, oh, the emotion I feel from Laura when she said that, she just wanted to put me down. That's what I feel from her. She wanted to do that. Now, I've got to be aware enough of my own emotions to know whether that's just an injury in me where I feel everybody's putting me down or whether she actually had a desire to put me down, don't I? Yeah. Let's say I assess it and it works out that, actually, I believe everybody's trying to put me down. So what would I do then? I would then go, okay, I need to be more open to what Laura said now because I've now recognised the fact that I've got this emotional injury, so I need to be more open to what she said now. So you're not going to allow yourself to do that if you're already in denial. If you're already just skipping over everything, you're not going to allow yourself to even go through that process. And I'm suggesting that going through that process is not a way of saying, I don't agree with you. I'm saying it gets to the point where you can assess it, and you can assess it with God's assistance.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So you can get God to eventually tell you whether law is right or not.
Okay.
And that's where you need to go.
And that's where I need to go. This could be way off my next point.
Yeah.
But I, when you were addressing Felix, I almost felt like I have the same unloving behaviour that he could be, but I could just be getting caught up in someone else's problems. Like,
well, I agree that you do. Then, you, like, there are some people here that have what I would call they think that everything I say applies to them, right? And some people here think nothing I say applies to them. And there is a large spectrum of people in between, where they think that bits and pieces they think apply to them do apply, and where pieces things they don't apply don't apply, when it's quite often the opposite way around, and so forth. So all of us have a very mixed reception to truth, is what I'm suggesting to you. But you need to discover what yours is.
Where I sit in that scale.
Yes. So does what I said to Felix apply to you? Don't you think if my treatment of Felix was that I said to Felix, I don't want another answer from him, I want him to work out where he's been unloving, and then you put up your hand and I ask you to ask a question, don't you think that if I felt what I said to Felix applied to you, that I would treat you exactly the same way as I'm treating Felix?
Yeah, I suppose I'm worried that, oh no, he's going to say the exact same thing to me because I'm sitting next to him.
Well,
I know
you're worried about that, but I would have, wouldn't I? If I was consistent, would I not?
Yeah, yep.
So the fact that I haven't tends to indicate what?
That I was way off with that assumption that I have the same.
So that would then, if it was me in that situation, I go, wow, I put up my hand and I was asked. Felix put up his hand and he wasn't asked. So I was thinking I had the same problem as Felix, but obviously I don't, is what I'd be saying to myself. Or AJ, obviously at least AJ doesn't believe I do, as you call me, AJ, doesn't believe I do. So, and he's pretty consistent. So that means he doesn't believe I have the same emotion as Felix. So maybe what was said to Felix doesn't apply to me.
Okay.
But you're not going that far. Why? Because you've been taught from your childhood that everything applies to you. Is that not? Everything negative applies to you, which is one of the injuries, right? So there's the injury. Bang, toes me my pain. Yeah. Thanks, Emma. Okay, well, let's move on to the next thing I want to say because I haven't got long to say it, have I? 14:56, 3 o'clock. Mary needs 20 minutes, take away 10 minutes. Okay. I've probably got 4 minutes to that, but I'll probably have to take longer. The next thing I want to say is about this state of, I've not written it up, but this stage of accepting our facade. So let's look at it. The thing I want to talk about is accepting the facade. This is going to be your most difficult thing that you've ever done in your whole life. of all of the pathway to God, this is the most difficult part of it. The most difficult part. And this is also the part where the majority of people leave the way, where the majority of people leave the path to God at this stage. Now, I've seen people in this on this path, you know, who think they're on the path for 6, 7 years, 10 years in this life, in the first century, some of them even longer. And yet when their facade was exposed, and it just had to be a single One single exposure. Once the facade is exposed, they're gone. The very first thing they tell themselves is that the person who exposed their facade is not Jesus. That's the very first thing they tell themselves. Then the next thing they tell themselves, because they now believe they don't have to listen when before they thought they had to, because I was saying I was Jesus, and I don't see the relationship there. You don't have to listen to me whether I'm saying I'm Jesus or not, right? Doesn't worry me either way what you believe about that. And I don't feel you have to listen to me whether I'm exposing your facade or not, right? But the reality is, I find it very interesting that once a facade is poked, the average person reverts not only to abusive behaviour and very unloving behaviour, but they're even willing to almost go the direction of completely opposing God's truth on the planet. And I've seen this happen over and over and over again, first century and now. Right? And it starts by the whole thing of like, he's not Jesus, I don't have to listen to him. You know, I can get to God without him anyway, and good luck with that. Because if you think you can get to God without God's messenger being involved in some way, you're going to really struggle with that. But anyway, good luck with that. There's not a single spirit in the celestial heavens that hasn't been helped by what I've taught them. Right. But that's what I'm saying. You don't have to believe it, do you? Because you have will. You're allowed to choose to believe anything you want. Is that not true? So, but what I notice is that every person who gets their facade triggered in even just one way, they go ballistic. They do. And it ranges from just complete denial and that's it, I'm not having anything more to do with it, right the way through to the other spectrum where they'll set up websites and to spend their whole life examining my life and attacking my life in order to prevent themselves from seeing their own facade. It's amazing what they'll do. I have friends from the first century who are still in the hills today attacking myself and Mary again, because now we're on earth, they can do that, because they didn't get enough of it in the first century. Right? Of attacking us because of something we did. In the first century, when I met Mary, there was a major meltdown in the majority of our friends. Right? And they took it out on Mary constantly, and with me, they basically ignored anything that I said to them if they thought it was influenced by Mary. And some of them are still in the hills trying to do that right now, 2,000 years later, ignoring the fact that their facade was triggered in some way. Now, in the last 7 years, I've seen this happen so many times, countless times. I've got hundreds of emails from all sorts of people all over the world, which are their breakup letters to me. The breakup letter usually takes the form of, I'm emailing you because I no longer believe you are Jesus, full stop. And then, all the bad things they then think I've done or said to them, stop. And then, so I'm having nothing more to do with you, stop. And then if they have had, stuff on the website that's been related to them, and I want you to remove everything that I've ever done with you. In other words, rub out the history of our relationship, stop. Bye. Usually without the bye. Right? Now, in almost every case, it has only been one conversation that has triggered that. One conversation. In almost every case. In some cases, I've had conversation after conversation after conversation, hundreds of conversations with them. And then there was one conversation that they did not like because their facade was exposed to themselves. They couldn't ignore it. And I was forceful enough to not allow them to ignore it. Does that make sense? Because after hundreds of conversations, by now I'm starting to get tired of saying the same thing 100 times, right? And so I say, no, that's enough of this. This is the problem. And until this problem is addressed, we can no longer have a relationship until this problem is addressed. Now, many of them were angry with me for many, many years before I addressed the problem. And I sit down with them and say, look, you cannot come to any more of our sessions because you're angry with me all the time. I cannot spend more time with you because you're angry all the time. Every time I raise an issue with you, you're angry with me again. I don't deserve that. An act of self-love is not to deserve, you know, to not put up with that anymore. And that's it. That's the last time I've ever seen them. Why? Because they want to stay angry with somebody. They want to be able to punish somebody. They want to be able to attack somebody. They think Jesus should have less self-love than the average person on this planet has, and therefore allow as much attack as he should be able to absorb. Ludicrous thinking. The more self-love I develop, the less that's going to happen, not more, right? So accepting the facade, and the reason why I'm saying these things to you is this. Accepting the facade and the accepting the facade Q&As that we've done, right? This is the area that is the most important area for you, because this is the area where it is life or death for you. This is the area where you are either going to run away or you're going to get through it, one of the two. And you know what I've found? Less than 5% of people who hear divine truth get through it. Less than 5%. Now, I'd like that percentage to be a bit higher than that. There's no reason why it couldn't be 95% or 100%. This tells us how addicted we are to maintaining our own facade. We are so addicted to it that any time our facade is actually confronted, most of us will just clear out or completely deny there's a problem whatsoever. Right? That's what we'll do. It's what we want to do. Right? It is the most serious, difficult time in your progression. The reason why is because you have received very little or any of God's love at this point, while at the same time being confronted with the majority of your emotions at the same time. There's no seeming reward for doing all this work, and that's why it's the most difficult time. Right? And because your assessment of what I say to you is very different to how I feel about what I say to you, because, of course, there's all these emotions and beliefs you have about certain things being said. You believe what I'm saying to you, you'll often believe, particularly if it's one-on-one conversation, you'll often believe that what I'm saying to you either does not need to be heard, which is a way of skipping over the facade altogether, or if it is heard, should be attacked, which is a way of not accepting your facade and rather attacking me for having one. And I'm suggesting to you, I've had one, you got one, everyone's got one, and it's time we just got on with accepting the thing and move beyond it. Do you know what I mean? But instead of that, the majority of us go, I'm not accepting it, that is so wrong, and you're now just attacking me, and off you go, and off you go. And I've seen person after person after person do this. And, you know, in some cases, like, you know, one case, here's another case, I've just got a sticky at the back that I need to re-put on. In one case, someone brought around a gift. It was just some veggies, and we refused the gift. That's all that happened. We refused the gift because the addiction involved in giving the gift was so intense that we had to refuse it. We said that to him. Since that time, we've not seen of him again, and he is now spending a bit of time attacking us rather than listening. Now, up until that time, I spoke with him for 5 years over hundreds of occasions. And he didn't listen to a word I said until Mary just said, no, we can't receive your gift because there's an addiction. There's been plenty of times I told him about the addiction, plenty of times I informed him about it, but it was just that one act and that was it. Another couple I know, you know, we've been to their place many, many times. And all of a sudden we started talking about a subject about his sexual projections at women. That was it. After that, they want nothing to do with us. That was it. Another occasion, a person sent me an audio recording device to record. This was early days, to record sessions. And so we recorded the session, and in the session came up questions about the fact that this same person had actually posted stuff on the internet attacking his partner. And I discussed how unloving that was with the audience. He heard that, and now he has websites that are dedicated to my slander. One event. In almost every case that I can think of where people have gone off track, it's always been one event. Just one event. Afterwards, they make up a whole series of events they think happened. But it was always just one event. And I see this happening over and over again. It's like revolving door, divine truth revolving door is some come in and just as many go out, and some come in and just as many go out. And there's a slow growth, you know, slow growth of people listening. But every person who has personal interactions generally comes in and goes out. And the main reason why that happens is because they can't accept their facade. So this is your danger point in your progression. Now, many of those ones who did that in our first century life, they did that, they came in, went away. Many of them went away, as I said, when Mary came into my life, they went away. And we never saw them again for hundreds of years. And then, of course, what do you think happened? They eventually came around to the fact that they had one, a facade I'm talking about, and that they needed to deal with it. And they were, you know, they had issues about getting angry and so forth. And eventually they dealt with those things and they've become celestial spirits. But they all have a regret, a single regret, that they didn't deal with their facade when they had the opportunity. And as a result, they had hundreds of years in many cases of pain because they chose that path. And that's why I raise this issue with you, because I'm trying to help you avoid hundreds of years of pain just because you don't want to accept your facade. Right? You want to ask Anna? Mic's coming down.
So I've done this. I've run away and got pretty mad. I didn't write you a breakup email, but no. I've done the rest of it.
Yep.
And I know for myself, it was my addictions being challenged. And from the stories that you're saying, there's that, like, that sense of shame in oneself that really gets brought up.
Yeah.
And that's why you're trying to teach us compassion as the first step, hey, so we don't get down that spiral.
Correct. Correct. You see, if you don't have compassion for yourself, and you're not used to having compassion from others, you won't feel that I'm compassionate with you when I raise issues. You won't, because you can't feel it as an emotion, not yet anyway. And so when someone's sharing truth with you, you don't think they're being compassionate. You think they're being attacking. You think they're being abusive, or blaming, or judging, or punishing, and that sense of a lack of compassion for yourself, which is actually the primary thing that needs to be developed, then you're reliant on your assessment of compassion from others, right? And this is a very, very dangerous thing, because that means that when truth comes to you, you're then looking at whether other people are compassionate. None of them are compassionate, so now my justification is to get angry. But if I'm compassionate with myself, I won't probably get angry. I'll probably sit with things and look at it honestly. And in particular, if I'm compassionate with myself, I'll be able to also see that that person does not want to harm me. That person doesn't want to punish me. That person doesn't want to hurt me. They're only raising these issues because they do believe in their heart that it is an issue that needs to be addressed. That's all.
It's like if we don't jump into our addictions, like I was saying before, of judging ourselves or self-pitying, like if we are able to feel it,
yep,
without engaging in it fully,
yep,
then it kind of allows more space
for the truth to enter. But it also, like before that even needs to occur, I think we all need to get to the stage where we can look at each other with love, no matter how many warts we've got on our face that everyone can see, you know, from an emotional perspective, we can look at each other with love. And this is what I'm saying to you. I see you with love, but when I raise an issue with you of truth, you don't see you with love. Right? And this is a major block to you accepting your facade. Because what happens is you have a knee-jerk reaction then, and off you go. And in that place, like, don't you think there's love, a lot of heap of spirits that go, you beauty, here's a ride we can jump on and just help them go down that track for a while. And that happens, right? And so what we do is that we end up causing a lot of problems for us just because we weren't compassionate with ourselves. Just because we didn't love ourselves enough to go, oh, hang on a sec, maybe I need to look at this. If someone who loves me is raising the issue and they've never demonstrated they don't love me through their past behaviour with me, then maybe I just need to look at it. And even if it's not true, I just need to have some compassion for myself, even if it is or not true. I need to be open enough and not be in denial, but just allow myself to see the possibilities. A person who has compassion wouldn't be worried about seeing the truth about themselves. In fact, they'd love seeing the truth about themselves. They'd really love it. So this thing of accepting facade, it's very important that you see the necessity of addressing any emotion that causes you to get harsh on yourself and then hard on others as a result of being hard on yourself. Very important, because this is going to lead you way off the base if you let it. Does that make sense? So what you raise is spot on, Anna. Exactly what we need, compassion. Compassion for the fact you didn't create your facade. You had a lot of very heavy training to create your facade. You know, I've talked to your mum about some of the training she still engages with you to try to still continue your facade. And as a result, you have now got a very strongly developed will to continue your own facade. And this applies to everyone. And we've got to see it as it is. That's how it is. We can change it, but we first have to see that's how it is and have compassion for the fact that we didn't choose it. It was thrust upon us. It was forced upon us. If you want to get Mike again.
I love my facade. I
Can you see that's because you're ashamed of what you believe is your real self?
I feel so crappy.
Yeah, yeah. And this is the fear, you see, every time this is why we love our facade, because we're actually afraid of who we really are. And this is why we've got to have our last 2 days. We've got to get in this discussion. We've got to get to the last 2 days, don't we? Because the last 2 days is all about who you really are. Who are you really? Right? Most of us have no idea who we are. And those of us who do think we have an idea don't like it. Because we were taught not to like it. Right? And one of the reasons why we feel crappy about ourselves has nothing to do with who we really are, but has a lot to do with how we've been treated. Does that make sense? It's got a lot to do with how we've been treated rather than who we really are.
Yep.
Laura, thanks.
To get to the stage where I recognise that I'm sinning and hurting others and just go, oh, I can just accept that. Like, it feels so foreign. It's like, how can I let myself off the hook? Like, I'm doing something bad.
I'm not saying to let yourself off the hook.
I feel like I need to browbeat myself because I'm not, like, I won't learn if I'm just like, oh, I just accept that.
Yeah, but see, this is a taught thing from your childhood. Most of you were taught by your parents to browbeat yourselves when something was exposed. A person who loves you doesn't want you to browbeat yourself. God doesn't want you to browbeat yourself. He doesn't want you to punish yourself over and over again for what's getting exposed. He wants you to just take responsibility for the fact that is and to develop a desire to address it. That's all he wants.
So we can learn without doing that.
Well, what you're doing, Laura, is you're imposing how your parents treated you upon God. You are saying that God will treat you the same way as your parents treated you, you see? This is your fear. Your fear is that if I let myself off the hook about my facade, as you call it, and I'm not suggesting to let yourself off the hook. I'm suggesting that what you need to do is take responsibility for it. And the way you take responsibility for it is by accepting it. And the way you accept it is by having compassion for it and then having compassion for the fact that you didn't create it. It was trained into you, and then you trusted it, and then you believed it, and then you loved it. But it happened, the real problem happened way before then. You were taught to love it and only it. You were taught to engage it, the facade, and only it. Right? You were taught.
It feels like another world, like so strange to make a mistake and just not, like just.
Yeah, what I'm suggesting to you is you've made thousands of mistakes and you've got to have compassion for each one.
And compassion is a flavour of love. It's not a correct.
Yeah, compassion is the expression of love.
Harsh correction.
Yeah, like God is not trying to harshly correct you. Don't you think your life is already painful enough? See, the laws are all already demonstrating and creating the pain. The law, breaking a law, pain results. Don't break the law, no pain. So don't you think you're already getting pain enough? Oh, I think you are.
If I make a mistake, I feel like I need more.
Yeah, no, I think you're already in enough pain and there's no need to create more, you see? And I feel that's the same for all of you. You're already in enough pain now. There's no need for somebody to come along and punish you. There's no need for someone to come along and hit you some more. It's like you're already punch drunk, aren't you? You're already punch drunk from this life, and particularly from your childhood, and you don't even realise that many of you are in denial of it. That's why you feel so sad. But the reality is you're already punch drunk from your life. No, somebody else doesn't need to come along and punch you into smithereens. And particularly you don't need to do it to yourself, right? You've already had it done enough to you. You know, the whole reason why you want to do it to yourself is because you've had it done enough to you. You've had it done too much. But what you need to do instead is go, no, this is how it is. This is how I am right now. I accept how I am right now. And it happened because of a lot of very unfortunate events, most of which I still don't really understand. And I'm not going to understand until I accept my facade and see what I'm creating, right? And if you have some love and compassion for yourself, you'll stop punishing yourself for this state you're in and start just allowing yourself to see it as it really is. Yeah, Lani.
If God is a loving...
You need to stand up for one of them.
Sorry.
And you need to go back a little so this camera doesn't see you. Sorry, Lani.
If God is a loving parent...
Yes.
And I imagine if I was a loving parent and one of my children came to me and said, oh, I've just done this really unloving thing, I would be such compassion to that child.
Exactly.
That child had acknowledged what they'd done, yeah. They'd accepted it, and they'd come to you with honesty.
Yeah, wouldn't it's wonderful.
It'd just be...
So what do you think God thinks of you doing the same thing?
So much love, exactly, so much compassion.
You know, this, the accepting a facade is just another way of saying you're starting to awaken to sin. Yeah. And what do you think God feels about your awakening to sin?
Yeah.
He's just over the moon about it.
Yeah.
Like literally, he's so happy every child who awakens to sin, he's just so happy because once you awaken to sin, he now has the beginning of a relationship with you.
Yeah. And then he can teach us then.
Then he can teach us.
Yeah.
Wonderful. So from God's perspective, it's like at last. If God could go, oh, at last, for you, he would. You know,
yeah.
That's how he feels. He loves you. He loves the fact that you've had awakening, a blossoming of yourself into awakening to what's happened to you, right, which is what the facade is all about. The facade is about all a whole heap of painful events happening to you and then a whole heap of extra painful events happening to suppress what happened to you, right? And don't you think he goes, look, it's pain upon pain here. When a person starts seeing it, this is the beginning of them addressing it. This is the beginning of the changing. Isn't that fantastic? And if you, as a parent, would love your child to be in that state where they admit they're wrong and can see exactly what is wrong and see it accurately, and you would be overjoyed as a parent, why do you think God would have a lesser response? It's only because we don't trust God's goodness, right? We have this monstrous view of God. One of the worst disservices that religion on this planet has done to God is to teach that God is this wrathful, almighty being who just wants to destroy your life the instant you do a little tiny thing wrong. Every single one of God's soul-based laws is to assist the redemption of you, the redemption of you from a place of harm and hurt to a place of joy and happiness. That's God's only desire. And to be frank with you, that's my only desire. I don't want to make your life harder. I don't want to make your life more difficult. I don't point out things to you to hurt you. I do it because I can see that this is the path to happiness. It requires a process, step-by-step process. First, the awakening to sin. Then having faith in God's love and getting educated by God. The awakening to sin process is an important part of the process because that is where we're using our will to remain unloving. So it's an important part of the process. It has to happen. We have to bring our will into harmony with the educational process. That's what we need to do. And the way we do that is awakening to sin. But awakening to facade and awakening to sin. It's all part of the same thing. And to be frank, this is also the area that is the most dangerous area for you, where you're probably going to run away and where you're probably going to run off and have times where you're away for years and then back again and away for years and back again until you get to the point where you realise what's driving it all. I've got to feel this terror that I have. You know, until you get to that point, you're away again, back again, away again, back again, skip over, skip over, skip over, and so forth. And if it means abusing the very person who's trying to teach you about it, then you'll do that at times. You will. And I'm suggesting you don't need to. What I'm suggesting is that if you accept your facade the first opportunity you have, which is a process that's going to take you years, it's going to take years of dedicated work because it's the creation of your and your parents' and society's sin. It's the result of this sin-based world that we live in. It's going to take some years to undo. But once you've undo it, you're going to have some freedom that you just cannot personally imagine. Just emotional freedom that you just cannot imagine. And joy and happiness as a result. It's just, honestly, you won't even recognize yourself. You won't even recognize yourself. Yay! Part of you, that's your fear, right? But you won't even recognize yourself. So that's probably what I'd like to leave with you, that thought that we need to get through this phase that's the hardest phase of your development. Now, I just would like to point out to you that the next 2 days of material, the majority of you are going to struggle to understand. The reason why is because you're not there yet. And when we're not at a place, it's harder to understand the place that we need to go to, right? We're presenting the material so you know what's ahead of you. You follow? You're going to desire to shut down in the next couple of days because it's a place that you don't understand yet, right? My suggestion is stay open. Remember, where you're at, for the majority of you, is accepting the facade thing. That's where you're at. Don't try to run ahead of it. Don't worry if you're confused. You know, don't worry if what we're presenting over the next thing, you don't really get it. That's all fine. You will get your pain when you feel your pain. You will get your facade when you feel and accept your facade. That's when you get things. Don't try to get things that you can't get because you're not there yet. Do you follow? All you do to yourself is a disservice. That's all you do for yourself. You try to, you know, we're so into impressing our parents, you know. You know, why do you think they have A, B, C, D, E, F, U as the grades for most, you know, education? A impresses your parents. B is not so bad. C is getting worse. D is getting out there. F is really quite bad, and U is unacceptable. Isn't it? You are used to being educated in a world that grades you over and over and over again. So you've gotten used to grading yourself and then judging yourself for not reaching the grade you thought you would. That's not how this path works. It doesn't work that way. God's not grading you. God is overjoyed each individual thing you learn about yourself and about God and about love and about truth. God's overjoyed with you. You know, every one of it's an A in God's eyes. You know? And even the people who use their will in the most destructive manner, God at least is going, oh, I created a wonderful person here who's able to just do whatever they want and see the results of what they create. Right? God has supreme confidence in his laws because he created them. He has supreme confidence in his laws to also correct you. He has supreme confidence in you because he created you. He knows that sooner or later, given enough time, the majority of the human planet, human race, whether it happens in now or 100 years from now or thousands of years from now, the majority of people are going to accept their facade at some point. Because he created a whole heap of laws to do it for you. And we'll learn about those laws later. But he created them for you. He's already thought of it. He's already thought that you might try to degrade yourself or that others might try to degrade you. And he's already thought of the way to redeem you. Clever, clever God. And loving God. Yeah. Anyway, I better leave it there because I've only given Mary like 20 minutes to do, well, not even that, to do her final talk. So that's the end of my group feedback session. Hopefully you've learnt something from those sessions, and Mary will probably help revise some of the things that you may have learnt there. Now, we're a good solid, we're a solid half an hour behind now. What do you want to do? Do you want... Mary was going to do like probably 30 or 40 minutes with you. Is that okay with you?
Yeah.
It just means that you'll finish probably about 20 past or something like that, four.
Is everyone okay with that?
Is everyone okay with that?
Four. Yeah.
Okay. So if you can come back at 10 minutes time, which is 20 to 4, you know, on this clock here it is anyway, just 10 minutes time, and then there'll be a 40-minute review and homework for you. Pleasure.